the power balance has definitely shifted, and it's just as likely now that the Western man would end up as the submissive partner. It appears that perhaps Neil Heywood, the British businessman, misread that whole situation as well, and unfortunately he has now ended up dead.
I'm sitting here with David Henry Hwang, who wrote the brilliant Broadway hit Chinglish, and I'm here because the play seems to have such strange echoes, really, of this new scandal that's riling China about the murder of a British businessman who seems to have been somehow in cahoots with a kind of dragon lady figure, right? Whose name is
Gu Kailai is the wife.
Who's married to a powerful communist party leader in the province, and now she's been charged with the murder of the British businessman. So, I mean, I was absolutely struck by the similarities of this character, Madame Gu, with the character in your play. Did you feel the same thing when you read the scandal in the New York Times?
Well, when it first started to break, some of my friends who are journalists or people who were China experts and had seen the play started emailing me and texting me about, oh, it's Chinglish as a murder mystery, or it's Chinglish a la Agatha Christie. And I'm sort of shy about that sort of thing, but I have to say, as the facts have been revealing themselves, there do seem to be an awful lot of similarities between the real-life case and what I wrote in the play, although my version was, of course, a comic version of the same kinds of
now,
events.
When you say there are similarities, I mean, what we're really talking about is the combination of corruption and intrigue and this other agenda. Can you talk a little bit about that, about Chinese political sort of and business mores that made you feel this?
Yeah, I mean, to some extent, a lot of these patterns are very similar in different sorts of cases that happen in China. So in a way, it's not totally surprising that my play and the Bo Xilai case dovetail. For instance, most of the time when you read publicly about someone being taken down for corruption in China, it's not the corruption that they're really being prosecuted for. It's some other political agenda, and the corruption becomes a convenient excuse to put them away.
Now, reading between the lines in this case, do you see a political agenda, or do you see some kind of crime of passion agenda, that perhaps she was having an affair with Heywood and the husband became angry, or conversely, that she became angry with him for some kind of jilted reasons?
Right. Well, you know, part of it is that we'll never exactly know, but in my play, of course, there is an affair between a Western businessman and the wife of a Chinese party leader, which some Chinese nationals, you know, were very skeptical about, like, oh, that would never happen. But here it would seem that there's a lot of chatter on the internet about the possibility of an affair, which has been now picked up by tabloid papers in Hong Kong and in Britain as well. So the fact that this chatter has not been taken off the web by the Chinese government would seem to imply that some degree of willingness to let this get out there.
Or indeed be putting it out there.
Yeah.
Which could also be the case. But of course, what's brilliant about your play is that what happens in this affair is the way that the Western businessman completely misreads all the kind of cultural signs, in a sense, that makes having an affair with a prominent Chinese woman different, perhaps, from having an affair with an American or a British woman. Can you describe what those differences are?
Well, I think that there is an assumption, because of the last 200 years of history, that when a Westerner goes into China, that he holds the upper hand. And certainly if he gets into a relationship with a Chinese woman, that he's the dominant figure and she's the kind of submissive lotus blossom, all those kind of stereotypical things. Whether that was ever true, I think it's definitely not true now. The power balance has definitely shifted, and it's just as likely now that the Western man would end up as the submissive partner. And that's the thing that I think the American businessman in my play misreads. And it appears that perhaps Neil Heywood, the British businessman, misread that whole situation as well, and unfortunately he has now ended up dead.
Reading the tea leaves in this case, what do you think is going on with Bo and the Chinese kind of establishment?
Well, I mean, basically, there's a power struggle going on between the what's left of the leftists, that is, you know, Maoists, or and the kind of capitalist free marketers. And Bo's style of governing was very populist in that he was trying to do a lot of government stimulus programs. He was trying to redistribute wealth. He was trying to go after corrupt officials and go after the mafia, and in many ways he did a lot of great things. He also kind of developed a cult of personality and became apparently quite authoritarian in a neo-Maoist way as well. So there was the agenda to kind of get him out of the way anyway before the new transition of power takes place later this year, and this provides a very convenient reason to get rid of him.
To bring him down.
Yeah.
Yeah, interesting. What do you think will happen to him? I mean, if he is chased out, what is the fate of somebody like him when you're sort of out of the picture?
In general, I would say nowadays, it probably makes sense not to make a martyr out of him, because there's a huge agenda on the part of the Chinese government, probably the primary one, to maintain unity. And so to execute him or even probably to lock him up for a long time would be problematic. I think my guess is they would let him continue to be free in a literal sense, but inconsequential.
Focus on his wife getting
They might own. Focus on the wife. Yeah. There is kind of a tradition of blaming the wife in Chinese history.
Mm-hmm. Well, thank you very much, David Huang. The piece in Newsweek is a fascinating kind of cultural look at China today and this case.
Great. Well, thank you for giving me the chance to write it.